Hi, welcome to my channel. I'm Isov Lame and today we're going to talk about ZBrush's interface. ZBrush interface. Some love it, many hate it. Regardless whether you're in the first group or the second group, there are a few things that you can do with the interface to make your life a little bit easier. Big shout out to Pavel Terehov's channel. I will link to it in the description. He's an amazing artist and it is thanks to his channel that I set up a custom interface of ZBrush for myself. If you can understand Russian, then I strongly suggest that you check out his three-part video about character design and ZBrush interface setup. He goes way more in depth into both subjects than I do, and I think his videos are an invaluable resource to any artist out there. By default, in ZBrush's interface, there are a lot of buttons that you're probably never going to find yourself using, while a lot of useful things are hidden in the menus and submenus and palettes and subpalettes. Recently, I was traveling, so I was reminded of this when I suddenly had to use the default installation of ZBrush, and of course, I forgot my personal UI setup at home, so I had to spend a little bit of time to set up the interface the way I like it, and that prompted the idea for making this video. I think it's well worth to spend a few minutes of your time to set up the ZBrush interface how you like it. That will save you so much time in the future going forward. So let me quickly show you how I go about doing it. Let's restore our default ZBrush UI. You can do that by going into the preferences and clicking on config and restore standard UI. Now the ZBrush is the same as it would be when you do a fresh install. To start customizing the interface, you need to go to preferences again, click on config, and then click enable customize. First, let's add some brush icons to be easily accessible on our interface. For the most frequently used brushes, I use shortcuts, but there are a couple of useful brushes that I don't use quite as often, so I never remember their shortcuts and I like to have them easily accessible. First, let's dock our brush menu so that we can work with it easily. The brush icons I want to take out to the interface are Select Rectangular, Select Lasso, Clip Curve, Slice Curve, and Trim Curve. You can see that some of these icons are already selectable and visible in the brush palette, but if some are missing, or if you want to add any other brushes, then we can add them by selecting them from the overall brush selection. To bring that up, press B, then select the brushes that you want to be added to the interface. Okay, now let's throw them into the bottom shelf. To move anything around in ZBrush, you will need to press and hold Ctrl and Alt. Then you left mouse click and drag the icon you want to move it to the new spot. If you drag the wrong thing out and you want to delete it, don't worry, just press Ctrl+Alt again and left mouse click and drag drop it into the working area. You can see that currently they're taking quite a lot of space. We can make it a bit more accurate by going to Preferences, Interface, UI and turning off the Wide Icons button. While we're here, let's also go to the palette and turn off one palette at a time. This will make sure that when you open a palette, it won't auto-collapse when you open another one. Alright, let's reposition our icons. Now let's tidy up the left shelf. Currently we have the brushes menu, which we don't really need anymore. We can always access it by pressing B on the keyboard. We can also get rid of the alpha and texture icons. These are handy to have and we will bring them back in, but in a much smaller size. First, let's replace the brush icon with the light placement. This will come in handy to tweak the lighting quickly on the model while we're sculpting. You may notice that at the moment it doesn't work, and that's because we have a matcap selected. The matcaps are materials that already have lighting baked in, so we need to switch to one of the standard materials to see the scene lighting affecting the model. There we go. Now let's move the material icon up to keep the large icons grouped together. And finally, let's get our alpha and texture icons back. Alright, that looks good. Next up, I will go through adding the elements I most commonly use while working. First, let's grab the stuff from the document menu. Let's dock it to have an easy access to it. The first things I want to take out of here are the document dimensions controls and the resize button. These come in handy for exporting previews out of ZBrush or when you have to match your workspace to an existing reference image of a specific aspect ratio. The next things I want to take out are the Cast 1 and the Cast 2 buttons out of ZUplink properties. Using this, you can set specific camera angles for ZBrush to remember, so you can easily snap back to those and check how things look from a specific angle. Now that we're done with the document menu, let's dive into the texture menu. From here, I take out the model opacity controls. These come in handy in tandem with the custom views and document dimensions when trying to match an image reference. Next, let's take out some brush masking buttons that I use all the time. First, let's free up some space at the top. We can safely get rid of the homepage and the lightbox icons. They take up a ton of space and don't add much good. You can always bring up lightbox by pressing comma on the keyboard. I'll also get rid of the live boolean icon because I use it extremely rarely. It may be different for you. If you want it back, it's found in the render menu under render booleans palette. Now, let's dock the brush menu and expand the auto masking palette. Let's grab topological, backface mask and mask by polygons out. This all come in very handy when working with multiple meshes or thin meshes of different groups. Let's move to the stroke menu. From here I take out the roll distance, which can control the smoothness of our brush strokes. I also take out the interpolate and the strokes count. These are not something I use often, but they can be fun. Now let's clean up and reorganize the right hand shelf. There are a lot of icons here that I never use. They clutter up the space and make it harder to find the ones I do. So let's get rid of some of them and rearrange the remaining ones. This looks a bit more manageable. Finally, let's take out all the useful stuff out of the tool menu. First, let's dock it. Now scroll down to the geometry palette. Open up the Z Remesher subpalette and take out the Z Remesher buttons and the relevant options. Next, let's do the same with Dynamesh. Next in line are the frequently used buttons from Modify Topology. Then from the subtool palette I take out the group split and the split hidden, great little tools for quickly splitting up your model into multiple subtools. And last, let's take out auto groups from the polygroup subpalette. With that, my customization is complete. You can save your customization file out by going to the preferences and save UI. This file can be used later when you move to another machine, for example. In order to make the custom UI stick, once you restart ZBrush, you just need to click store config. Last but not least, it may happen that on different screens with different resolutions, you may see that not all of your icons fit, or maybe you want to take out more things onto your custom shelves. In order to change the size of icons and fit more things in, you need to go to Preferences, Interface, UI, and change the icon size value. The change will take place once you restart ZBrush.